Well, good morning, good afternoon, good evening, depending on where you're coming to in the world. It's episode 10 today of the Low Down and Low Code. I'm Ryan Dude, your host for the day, and joined with my co-host Rob Koplowitz. Rob, great to see you again.
Always great to be here, Ryan.
So we've got a fantastic episode lined up today. We have Chris Obdam, co-founder and CEO of Betty Blocks, with us. Betty Blocks has been on the scene for quite some time now, and made their mark in the world of low code, and especially being a European based company. And so we love to talk to the folks who come from EMEA and learn a bit about the background and some of the differences between approaching the world of low code software from that part of the world versus the southern hemisphere, where I spent a bunch of my time, versus the US market. And so, Chris, just to get started, love to learn a bit about your origin story. I know you started the business with your brother, so it was an interesting adventure to keep it in the family. And so just be great to hear how you came to the world of low code and what drew you in, and what's kept you here for over a decade now.
Oh, yeah. Thank you for having me. Yeah, my story started it's 20 odd years ago, straight out of university, where my brother and I were planning to start a company. I had the development skills, and he was the commercial financial person. So we started building a software development company, just a bespoke software company. And over the years, we grew bigger and were quite successful. And we had one thing, and that was our internal software. And I always joke that the same as with the teeth of the dentist, right? They're always a little bit shady. And I think it's the same thing with the internal software of a software company, right? It's also a little bit shady and broken here and there. And we had the same problem. And my brother asked me, so why don't you guys build me something that I can just fix this myself? He was more the operations guy. So we had a lot of developers. So every time you need to ask me or one of the team to fix something in our invoicing or whatever, project management software. And so he was, could you just make it more easy? Because I don't want to learn to code. And that's what we did, I think, like years ago. And we started building something which is now the product of Betty Blocks. So in a way, my brother was the first citizen developer or business technologist that we had. And he's still building applications till this date for a variety of reasons. And he likes to do it as well. So I think that is, at the end, how we started building it, because we had this internal problem. And then we found out that we were not alone. There were a lot of different companies who struggled to build software, and they were looking at the IT department and saying, hey, can you build me this or that app because I have a business problem? And like, even on, I don't know, 15 years ago, the answer was, no, I'm busy upgrading to SAP version X. And nothing has changed in all these years, because that's still the same thing. So we found out that within, let's say, somewhat larger companies had the same problem, that there were business problems who needed to be solved by people in IT, but they were busy doing other stuff. So our goal was always to enable, as we called it then, tech-savvy business users. There was no other term to it. And then, as was mentioned in the first episode of your podcast, and John and Rob were working at Vorster and came up with the term low-code, and we were not aware that we were doing that. But we found out we were. I think that is more or less how we started. We started as a no-code platform because of our position, and moved away from that for a variety of reasons to now being a low-code for citizen development platform.
Let's dig into that, because that's a fascinating conversation. I know for a fact, so I did research with John Reimer for, I don't know, 15 years. I'm very doubtful that him and I have the same definition of low-code versus no-code. I think if the three of us here gave our definitions, there wouldn't be a common definition. But we're kind of most interested in your definition, Chris, especially given some of the journey you've been on. Tell us about no-code. Tell us about low-code. Tell us about what drove that transition to a little bit more of a low-code mindset at Baybox.
Yeah, so there was an analyst, and it might have been you, Rob, or somebody else, who defined it to me, which I like, that no versus low code is a marketing positioning statement. And I think that is the only right answer, is that it's a marketing positioning statement. Because we're all looking for technical definitions of what it is. But it's really hard to do, and everybody has his own definition to it. But if I try to explain what the difference is now, and that it has been different like 5 years ago, maybe, is that no code, the term no code has been claimed by the independent professional space in terms of smaller, restricted hyper-automation tools. And that is one of the reasons why we moved away. Then if you look at no code, there were tools who were just doing some small and smart configuration stuff with forms who went on becoming a no code platform. And that's why we moved away from that, because it's not who we are. Because with no code, people expect that there's a limitation to it. You can only do any, you can only do build apps without code. And we have always allowed to do to add code to your application or to extend our platform, is how we call it. So I think that that is why we moved away. Also because our platform grew bigger and stronger, and to make sure that we were able to deal with that positioning as well. But that's how we explain. It's also because we, when we started framing our platform as no code, it was also against the current low-code players, to be honest, right? It was a marketing positioning statement. And those platforms, especially back in the day, it was officially low-code, but if you really look at the applications that were built then, it was like 70% was code extensions, right? All of the horizontal low-code players out there, right? Back in the day, there were a lot of code still. And that was not 100% only because of the platform not being able to fix it, but it was also the mindset of the developer. At that moment, I use stuff that I understand from the local platform, and then I just add code to it because that's what I know. And that has changed over the years as well. So people see low-code by far more as how we meant a no-code would be like 5 years ago or maybe longer ago. So I think that is important to mention it. On one end, it was very much how no-code is perceived at this moment. And that is Zapier, it's also no code, and that's not the association that we have with our platform.
Yeah, that makes sense. So if you, I mean, an interesting spin on this, right? And to your point, it's a lot of marketing speak. Nothing wrong with that. We all have to do it, right, to help people understand where we sit relative to other players. We kind of get into the actual skills and background and personality of the person building things. You talked about the tech savvy employee, right? Which we used to have this term in Nintex. We talk about macro girl, macro boy, right? The person who could write a function in Excel or what have you. A lot of it becomes a mindset thing and a way of thinking. So if you think about the concept of citizen developer that you talk a fair bit about through your collateral, How do you think about citizen developer or the tech savvy person? How do you define them within Betty Blocks? How do you go about finding them, and how much of a sort of a technical mindset does that person have to have? Right, because if you take the concept of code out of the equation for just a moment, a lot of low code technologies still require you to think like a programmer. If that makes sense, right? So how what does the perfect citizen developer look like for you, and then how do they fit in a larger concept? Now we hear about this term fusion teams. So where do they sit there, and how are they working together within your platform?
I think that's a really important question. But we always start with differentiating citizen development versus the citizen developer, where the citizen developer is a persona or a role in a software development cycle. And citizen development is an enterprise program, as we call it, where you allow people outside of the IT department to decentralize, or in a decentralized way, to build applications. Having that said, we always use three different personas: a citizen developer, a business technologist, and a low-code developer, right? And if you combine them in one team, you have a fusion team. So we always explain that a citizen developer is the person who only configures something. They use a template, which we have in our store. They configure it, and they don't build. So if you look at that first thing, I think that's really important to note, where the second one, a business technologist, really does a development in a full-time scale. So that is a upgraded version of that tech-savvy business person. Because as you have discussed in earlier podcasts as well, People upgrade to different roles as well. They might start at just configuring an app somewhere, but they like it. They see that they can do it. So maybe even after the first app, they have moved from being a citizen developer, but just configuring something based out of a template that somebody else made for you to, hey, I think I can make my own templates or work without a template. So it's important to note that as well, where the low-code developer really does the stuff that does not fit in the low-code platform in general, right? Where there's nothing in the store, there's nothing in the feature, so you need to extend something with code. That's where the low-code developer comes into play. And it's always important to note as well is that those are roles, not really personas. So in some project, you're the citizen developer hat, and then you're the business technologist. So there's no black or white here. But I think the configuration versus building is a really important differentiation, because a citizen developer, that even the tech savvy user, doesn't have the mindset of a developer, as you mentioned, Ryan. They don't want to think in programmatic concepts. They just want to fix their problem. One of our popular phrases that we use internally is turning problem owners into problem solvers. So it's really about the problem owning bit, and you want to fix it. And so you don't want to bother about, am I doing this right? No, you just find a template and which solves your problem and then fix it. Does that make sense?
It does make sense. And I kind of want to dig into this a little more. And I actually have a couple of questions, or maybe a comment and a question and then a follow-up question. So I think one of the things that drew Ryan and I together, and as well as John Reimer, who's been on a number of these podcasts, you see this theme throughout the Lowdown on Low Code podcast, is this concept of a broad-based a set of business developers, right, where people are using low-code tools, maybe not as extensively as Excel, but they're accessing them, right? Everybody in the company comes in with a developer mindset, with an idea of process optimization, and is involved in the development of software, some of which is large, some of which is this long tail of situational applications that start to beat out the Excel spreadsheets from the organization. So the first question is, Chris, are we smoking the curtains here? I mean, you're on the ground, you see it. Is this the vision that we're going towards, or are we crazy?
Maybe if you can rephrase the vision, maybe in one sentence again.
Everybody becomes a developer.
Sure, I get it.
Almost everybody in the company is involved in software development in 5 years.
I think that is one of the, it might be the biggest misconception in low code in general. For the simple explanation, right? Imagine you're a grocery, big grocery store organization. Right. So, okay, you have people on the floor in the grocery store. What happens if they become a developer? Right. So that whole phrase, although respectfully said, of course, doesn't make any sense because it can never happen. And I think that is only for that reason, it's a misconception. And the other reason is that I know for sure that not everybody wants to be a developer as well. And that's important as well, because what we have learned in our own citizen developer adventure is that sometimes for some strange reason, it felt like one of our customers was pushing us to train people who don't want to be trained. But yay, hey, you are a citizen developer platform. Anyone can build an app. And we have used that phrase as well, unfortunately, I would say. So we were really pushed by a customer. Well, train this person who doesn't want to be trained and make them successful. And we were like, oh, it doesn't work like this. And so I think all of us are getting more to a more realistic approach to it. That's what we call it. It's a program, right? And in a program, there are different steps to it, and there are different maturity levels. So if you have no experience in software development, don't start with handing out the low-code platform to everyone and hope for the best. Right? That's not how you start. You first need to just make a baby step first and just build an application in a very controlled environment where you have experienced people there, because if you fail that first application, the whole program is going to fail. And so although it's of course a provocative statement and sometimes it helps, I think it's the wrong way to approach it. And I wrote a blog about it as well, and explained that we were guilty of creating that image in the market as well. So maybe this is the right moment to say sorry to everybody that we shouldn't have said that.
I think we'll probably all played a part in that one, right?
But let me probe on that a little further, because I said I had two questions, and certainly I don't think any of us are envisioning the grocery store clerk writing code. But I did actually once take an Uber ride with a person who was trying. He said he was trying to get away from his wife, and his real job was he was a claims adjuster for a aftermarket auto insurance company. And while he wasn't writing the code, he was deeply involved in some code that they were writing as the subject matter expert. So we do get more broad-based in, but we do get the business, maybe even the grocery store clerk, closer to the development process, closer to helping us optimize our business. And we do get a more broad base of developers, right? Maybe many of whom hopefully were not trained to be professional developers. And Chris, you kind of mentioned, okay, that can quickly get you into trouble. How do we get away from that? How do we avoid that? How do we take these people who are not trained developers and say, we have things like application development lifecycle, we have things like QA testing, we want more development, but we want to train the organization on how to do it right with governance and guardrails. What's been successful for BetyBlocks in that regard?
I think the part of that is already in the question, right? So it's to train the organization. And I've always enjoyed in the earlier days talking to you and John as an analyst, because I think not everybody was aware that this is so little about technology, but it's so much about an organizational change and how to manage that. So it's about training the organization and taking it one step at a time. So what has worked is first is customers to acknowledge it, right? And that's why the misconception anyone can build an app without any training or whatever is the wrong one. Because if you want to roll it out at scale, that is the question that we always have. They might approach us, I want to build one or two apps, and we're like, okay, that's cool, but how many apps do you think in an ideal world you want to build every year? You want to build 10, okay. How often have you built apps? So it starts with getting the organization to acknowledge the fact that it is something that takes time and that you need to train your organization. And if you have that in place, it really helps to make sure, of course, you need to have the right platform for it as well. And I might am a bit too biased, of course, here, but I think that really is important. And of course, I need to promote our BettyBlocks platform, but I think it is about choosing the right platform for the right need as well. Because if you're building an application or building multiple applications at scale, there aren't that many platforms out there who can really facilitate that. There are thousands, maybe, of platforms out there who can help you build one app and maybe build 20 as well. But controlling that cycle, that innovation life cycle, or that software life cycle, are very little platforms who can facilitate that. And so what we think is important, and how we phrase, let's say, the near future of our platform, is what we internally call that we want to be more than a development platform. We want to facilitate that whole life cycle. And we have upgraded it from a software development life cycle, an SDLC, to a innovation life cycle. Because you need to start at the ideation phase. You need to start earlier and you need to end later, because it's not about software development. It's about solving problems. So we see a role for us as a platform that you capture the problems in the platform somewhere and you discuss which tool do you need to use? Do you really need to solve this? Are you allowed to solve this? Because when I talk to CIOs, there are two big risks that they see with doing low code at scale. The first one is everybody going to be a developer? And how do I manage that, right? Who is allowed to build? How do I know what they are building? And the second one is, if they have built something, how do I know that it's still being used? And that is creating a return. That is our vision to this topic, is that you need to be, as a platform vendor, you need to be holistic to it. Because otherwise, you're only fixing a very small part of it. And if we're all saying, and I've heard you guys talk about that in this podcast before, if we state that this is not that much about technology, but more about organizational change and about creating a culture, then you need to have a platform to facilitate that as well. And of course, yeah. I'm a little bit biased, but I think regardless of the platform that you choose, if that is important, make sure that you look for that in the platform and offer that. and make sure that you work on creating a community and all that stuff that has been said before as well.
Yeah, I think that's, I mean, it's interesting, Rob, right? Because we've talked a bit about this, that, and if there's this sort of guilty of apologize for, I think is all of us vendors in the space, because for just the longest time, and it makes sense because there was so much to do, just obsess about the build part of it, right? Like, let's help more people build more apps, right? And didn't take the time to step back and say, what's the larger problem space? And as a result of that, you miss out on just the ongoing, to your point, like actually going all the way back to the ideation, innovation, the capture cycle, right? The suggestion box, how can we make things better in our company? That's where you get people at all phases of the company. So the grocery clerk or whoever it happens to be, not necessarily someone who's with a computer all the time. What's fascinating to me in that world is obviously with my own background in the world of product management, user experience design, that those are two components that the disciplines anyway tend to get missed out in this, right? So I'm first up to your point, hey, I've got all these apps I could build. Which ones should I build, right? So there's a huge product management prioritization exercise. So even just giving people tools to say, you've got 50 suggestions here, how might you score them, sort them, filter them, and decide what to tackle next with the people you have, right? And then the next part of it is, how do you design a quality application? And I think one of the big challenges we have is, you know, there's some sort of low-code tools that are pretty rigid in what you can design, right? Like, hey, you're going to get this table-looking thing. You might get a form that's in a flow layout. Dashboards, fairly standardized. And there are others that I know you're in this camp as well that start to gravitate more towards custom UI design, especially for, you know, user-facing, customer-facing type scenarios. And so one of the challenges there is that if these people don't have technical skills, the likelihood they have user experience design skills isn't particularly high. So how do you think about bringing some of that skill and mindset into, say, a Fusion team to help people build better apps for the end consumer? Because I know sometimes you hear the complaints from the end consumer of the application, right? But this thing's hard. It's not so easy to understand. How do you think about capturing more of that into the upfront process?
I think that's really an important topic, because if you differentiate maybe low code versus no code, one of the upsides of choosing for a low code platform is that you can really optimize the experience for the end user. Right? If you're saying the other tools are often more rigid, or if you need that it's okay. But then, of course, as you're saying, how do you make sure that everything is in the right branding, but also is optimized for good UX? And the vision that we have for that is to create a no-code toolkit, as we call it. So if you're building application at scale, you need to do, at the right moment, a upfront investment in making sure that you define design principles and also create templates and specific components and themes for that, so that when somebody is actually building an app, they need to think less about branding and all that other stuff, because if they're using for that specific company optimized toolkit, they're already working within those guardrails and those guidelines. And that is the first thing to look at. And after that is make sure that you set the right example as well. Often the first apps are not the most beautiful ones, and that doesn't help for the consecutive ones. So in an ideal world, you want to have a showcase app within the company, right? If you want to build something, right? Set the standard high from the first beginning. And make sure that you make that a showcase app, but also to provide the tooling with templates and specialized and configured components that they don't need to think about that, because it's already there. And it's, of course, the theory in practice is a little bit harder, but that's how it should go.
So there's a couple things just on a personal note regarding this podcast. There's a couple of things that constantly amaze me and humble me. And one is that folks like you, Chris, are willing to come on the show, that we've had these, you know, senior people, CEOs from really cool and innovative companies that are willing to come on and talk to us about that. And we're so delighted. And on the other topic, you know, we had Andrew Hogan from Figma on, who's the head of Insights, which was wonderful. And Figma has continued that conversation, right? They've continued to work with us, their research department, on how to bring design not just to your hero apps, not just to your face of the company apps, but to be able to do that at broader scale is something I think that they would like to get involved in. And they've been gracious enough to include us in that conversation a little bit, which is so flattering. So shifting gears a little bit here, Chris, this is a question that we have asked all of the vendors that we've had on to date. We're going to continue to ask the question. I don't know if you had a chance to listen to the podcast with Merv Adrian, where we talked about evaluative research, Gartner versus Forrester, and their approaches to evaluative research. And one of the points we really want to make is that not every product is designed for every use case, right? You know, we'll often say if WaveMaker finds himself in a deal against Kissflow, somebody's in the wrong place. So one of your account executives walks into an opportunity, sitting down with the CIO, whoever the decision maker is. What is the context that they're hearing? What is it that says, this is perfect? This is what BettyBox is designed to do. What's the ideal scenario for you? What's the ideal problem to solve?
I think it starts with the long-term strategy that a company has. If you talk in ideal setups, right? Because sometimes they don't know what they need yet, but assuming they know, is that they want to build applications at scale. And they want to make sure that they can facilitate in the right way. The second question would be, right, what are we talking about in terms of apps? Because there are low-code platforms where you build one app and it takes still 1.5 years, right? Because it's really big app. That is, of course, also not what we do. So it's about building apps at scale. So that means that you're building, let's say, I always explain, like, medium-sized apps. Sounds really boring, but it's actually what we do. It's not the smallest ones, because the smallest ones are like the hyper-automation ones.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right? Because if you look at Power Automate, they call it an app. But it's, for us, it's not an app. It's just one workflow, right? And there are different tools we call that an app, which is fine with me, as long as we all understand the difference. So we always explain, right, if you want to build, and you can also call it departmental apps. And if they want to build that at scale, I think that is where we look toward. And if they want to do that in a decentralized way, because if you only keep it tucked in to an IT department, a small team, internalized, we can add less value to it. So that is how we approach it normally. And there are, of course, different let's say application characteristics where we would look at as well. Right, if you were doing a lot of data moving from left to right and stuff like that, right? That's of course not what we do. There are better platforms for it. If you just want to build a one-page form, right? It's too big. So that's how we normally look at it. So but the big question that we first have, and sometimes it's more a latent need, so you need to uncover that, because they think they only need 2 or 3 apps. And the question that we always say is, okay, well, in an ideal world, right? Could it be 6? Yeah, it could be 6, right? And how many departments have you talked to? Yeah, 2. How many departments do you have? 20. Oh, so in an ideal world, it could also be like 100, right? Yeah, okay. And you don't have any capabilities. So for us, it's a lot about, and I was asked a very simple question to a prospect if I talk to them. Do you agree that for your company, the common phrase, every company is an IT company, or every company is a software company. Is that appropriate for your company? Well, do you agree with that? And then often the answer is yes. And then my second question is, do you have any idea how to get there? And then the answer is more often, no, I don't know, if they're honest. And that means we have the right person in front of us. And of course, it is a simplification of everything, but I think that is how it is. In the end, low-code platforms are there to build capabilities with companies, right, who want to be or who needs to be a software company, because that is how the world is in 2024.
Yeah, I think it's that scale element of it is what's so critical, right? And I really appreciate the fact you talk about the medium-sized app. I'm a huge fan of just that. Being realistic about that kind of thing, right? And not in a bad way at all. You know, as I was used to tell people, sort of worked in a world where it's almost like I specialize in taking out the trash. And here's the thing. Nobody wants to know about that. They just want to know it's done. It happens on a Wednesday morning before they wake up. And if it doesn't get done, everyone gets really frustrated, and it's good to someone taking out the trash, right? And I know people I worked with in the past are like, that's a horrible way to describe it, Ryan. But so you said there's all these medium-sized problems that just never get addressed in your business. And to your point, there are tens, there are hundreds, there are thousands, there are tens of thousands of them that need built. And you need a tool that helps with that, right? So it's awesome. You're the first vendor I think we've talked to that's kind of come at it from that perspective. So it's good to hear.
And there's the product person in me, of course, but our platform can still build big apps as well, right?
Yeah, that's, we can do that too.
That is not. But if they want to do that, that is not what we want, right? So I need to be strict towards myself as well. I think there's an interesting sexiness to those boring apps as well, because some of them are very important, and often in software, it's always about if mission critical and whatever. But as you're saying, if the trash is not being taken outside, it becomes mission critical pretty fast, right?
Yeah.
There are a lot of them out there, right? So there are tons of cool companies that I can name, right, where it's not really cool what the app does, but I know that if we remove that app, right, that the company comes to not really a standstill, but a small crisis will emerge somewhere. And I think that's cool as well. And I like the scale of it as well, because we can really make an impact. If you're building one application, it's to be a local platform where you could high code it or whatever, or do a SAP implementation and customize it. So there are different options. But if you want to do it at scale, the challenge becomes different. And I like that challenge, right? It's kind of hard, organizational change with your customers. It's really hard. I can even mention. But it's also the thing that we find the most maybe fun to do as well.
Can I throw in a quick thought here? Just because this was so near and dear. So when John Reimer and I were writing this research together, for the better part of 10 years, there was this phrase that we used, and we had it written down on a whiteboard, and we would always go back to it. And it was really when we were all focused on the concept of digital transformation. And we had this phrase that was, your digital transformation strategy is exposing your ugly operational processes. And the story we used over and over again was the story of, like, it became legendary at Forrester, the pizza oven story, where, there was a retailer who was managing this back ugly process in the back, which was, product came in and it was damaged. It shouldn't go into inventory, right? Except for what was happening is they were trying to become more online. They put that into available inventory online before it was checked, right? So the idea of automating the process of checking and being able to take that out of the available inventory works perfectly in a brick and mortar stuff. It just never makes it into the store, so it's not available. But it was being made available to the public. They were being told, this is 2-3 days delivery. Oh, it's broken. It's 8 weeks delivery. That times 1,000 is kind of those middle ground processes and those things that are running around manually. So I love that phrase, though. Yeah. So thanks for letting me say it.
It's that word, Rob. It's the operational process part of it. So the polite version of taking out the trash is actually, I used to, in Intex, I'd tell people, we're like the oil in the engine, right? We don't make the engine. So, that's your mission critical strategic, what have you. And I think the best thing as a software vendor is to tell people when to use something else. Hey, that thing there. We used to tell people, use Mendix for that. Use our systems for that. Use Power Platform for that. These ones over here, this is what we specialize in. We're like the oil in the engine. These are your engine. But if you have no oil in the engine, things come unstuck pretty fast. Engine breaks, right? And so a bit to that point, like you take away the oil, you find out pretty fast what's going on in the business. So it's good to hear that. So look, one thing I want to do, Chris, it's a little bit of time now, but you guys had a fantastic capital raised during, sort of COVID era, was tough times, and put some good money in the bank, and got to believe a lot of that goes back into product. And in that regard, when we think about, over the horizon roadmap, everyone right now in this industry is full steam ahead. Everybody has a chatbot. I'd like an app that blah, 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 and something manifests in front of you. I don't know that necessarily makes things any easier than it was before dragging and dropping. There's a reason we settled on a visual metaphor, because words often were a really poor way to describe application requirements, right? We found those problems in the 80s and 90s, and actually before that. So when you think about AI, How do you think about the impact that it's going to have on the products, low code products, to the customers consuming those, how it might change the way we build applications? And you know, what you've got a toolkit out there already. Love to hear how that's going and how people are thinking about incorporating, infusing AI into your platform experience.
Yeah, I noticed there was a poll on the LinkedIn page of the Analysis No Tech LinkedIn page, which was about do we expect that AI will make low-code disappear or something like that. And I think that was the local people, I don't know, 60-70% were like, no way, or something like that. and you were leading the witness a little bit as well, right? That we moved away from the text part to the visual part for a reason. So I think it's going to have a big impact on software development in general. But I think it, now the dust is settling a little bit, we see that it all is settling in the assistant area, right? Not in the replacement area. So right, if you don't have AI in your platform to assist your development, right, you will have a problem. If you can't build a AI-infused app on your platform, you'll have a problem. And both of that, we got that covered. What I've noticed is that when I... so. 70% of app development is the visual part, and especially the UI part is still for us is most often where a lot of the magic happens, right, in building prototypes and expanding and everything like that. And if you need to prompt that, and we have done our tests and we have a feature as well, if you prompt that, it takes more time than you just browse through a library of templates and find the right one. So you need to solve that problem with AI first, that those standard set or that custom set of templates is a slower way than prompting. It might be that you find the right template with AI, right? Something like that, or you update it. But then by far, you are, of course, not replacing low code with AI. And I think it doesn't make sense either. You just need two low codes and make the development process faster. There's one important topic to it is that, as I mentioned, what we see with our customers when building applications at scale, the actual development part is not the big issue, right? So I was just thinking about the early days, right? We're from the Netherlands. So there was a big other vendor, which was on the show last time, Nick Ford from Mendix, right? Nick's a really cool guy. And we've always liked Mendix, would always try to just, I don't know, annoy them a little bit here or there, which didn't really work, to be honest, because they did an awesome job. But they had on their website, I don't know how many years ago, it was, they had like four times faster than normal development. And we were like, man, we're faster. So we put eight times faster on our website. We were young, and that's what happened. To be honest, we had a lot of shootout those days with Mendix, and it was actually faster, right? We had a faster approach, so we thought we could do it. But what we found out is that people don't care.
Yeah,
if it's 1, 2, 3, 8 times faster, because they know that the actual human part of it is still the bigger issue, right? Gathering the requirements, knowing which app to build. So if I would put my money in terms of, yeah, I would invest it in the non-development part more to optimize that, because you're solving a bigger problem. And everybody can add AI to the development bit. I was just doing a Google query earlier, AI wireframes, because somebody mentioned it. I don't know, like 30 vendors already came up. So there's no added value. There's no room in the space there. But the experience that we have is that the problem is somewhere else. So I'm not ignoring it at all, right? But I think that the speed is not the big issue for the at-scale bits.
That's the product manager in me is just always asking, who am I? What's my problem? And to your point, oftentimes my problem isn't, you know, if you go, okay, we took low code, you're 20 times faster, you're 50 times faster, you're how much faster than code. Great. And then all of a sudden you go, and it took 2 months to actually figure out what to build. And so that's where you can get your big bang for a buck, right? And so it's great to see people thinking about that, because I do think we're, I understand for marketing perspective, from an investor perspective, you have to have the cool story, right? But at the end of the day, it's good to see people stepping back to first principles and figuring out what is it that people need here to be successful. So look, Chris, I really want to say thanks for coming on the show. It's been a fantastic discussion. I appreciate all your insights and perspectives, especially, it's always good to get that balance, as you say, having Nick on and get the European mindset into some of this as well. So obviously differences between how people think about problems and approach them around the world. So that diversity of perspective is really valuable. And I want to say thanks to everyone for joining us today. Rob, thanks for joining us on the show, and have a great one. We'll see you next time.
Thanks for having me.